Hello physios, welcome to the new age classroom, Physiotherapy Simplified. In this video, we shall discuss about basic kinetics and their clinical applications. These are levers and forces, torque, line of pull, and angle of pull. When you use a lever, the motion that results might be linear or angular. Linear motion is movement in a straight line, whereas angular motion is rotational movement through an arc. So, all your joints produce angular motion, be it elbow flexion or knee extension. But you consider activities such as walking a linear motion, because in that case your body is considered one segment and is moving in a straight line. Let's consider linear motion in a little detail here. True linear motion is one that happens in straight line, and the segment is isolated and unconstrained like a box moving over a surface. But in humans, such motion is not possible because every segment is connected to another, so motion of one segment will show motion at another even if it is not visible. Let's take an example. When you reach out to grasp an object, the forearm hand movement that occurs can be called as linear motion, but you cannot call it true linear motion because forearm hand segment is connected to humerus, and as your hand moves to grasp there is small amount of rotation at both shoulder and elbow joints even if it is not visible to your eyes. Now, let's discuss angular motion. When talking about true angular movement, remember that all the segments of an object must move around a fixed axis in a curved path, i.e., each segment moves through same angle at the same time and at the same distance from the center. Now let's consider the example of hand shaking here. When you shake hands with someone, it might appear that forearm hand segment is moving through true angular movement, i.e., segments moving through same angle, time, and distance from center, but actually all joints are slightly shifting from their true rotatory path. Now you might wonder about what we call the body movement, if not linear or angular movement. When segments move through combination of rotation and translation, which is what happens with human body, we'd call them by various terms. Let's have a look at these terms and where we can observe them in clinical practice. When you see combination of translation and rotation of a segment in two dimensions, i.e., parallel to plane and with maximum of 3 degrees of freedom, this motion will be called as curvilinear motion. In this combined motion, rotation would occur around an axis that is called as instantaneous axis of rotation. This axis is different from true rotatory axis and is seen in most joint rotations of our body. Let's understand this in an easy manner. When we drink water, for example, forearm hand segment rotates around coronal plane at elbow, whereas shoulder rotates around anterior posterior axis. This motion uses 2 degrees of freedom and thus produces curvilinear motion at forearm hand segment. Now that we've seen motion, let's have a look at how that motion is produced and what is it called. The force that levers produces causes rotation at a joint is called torque. Mathematically, it is the product of force and length of the force arm, so you'd express torque with the unit Newton meters. This force arm is clinically referred to as moment arm. Now you might wonder, how is torque applicable in your clinical practice? The thumb rule here is, longer moment arm produces more torque. So, if you are working on strengthening hip abductors of your patient, keep your resistive hand at ankle rather than at patient's knee. This will require your patient to produce more effort to abduct your hip, and you'd have to give less force as resistance. On the other side, if your patient has weak quadriceps, ask him to bend his knee while doing exercises like SLR. As the resistance arm is shortens, their weak quadriceps will easily carry the limb through leg raise exercise without needing therapist's assistance. Now, another way to use torque in your clinic is that you can change torque by changing force. This principle can be used while you're aiming to strengthen a patient's muscle. For example, if you're trying to strengthen quadriceps, place the weight at ankle rather than knee. Research has shown that a 4.5 kg weight at ankle produces twice as much torque as a 2 kg weight at knee. Besides longer moment arm, this occurs because as muscle goes through the extension exercise, the muscle's line of pull and angle of pull changes. Now you might wonder, what are these two principles? Let's discuss them, shall we? Basically, line of pull is a line of action of a muscle as it applies force over its attachments, and the direction of this line is usually indicated by the direction of tendon's attachments. You see, when a muscle contacts, it creates a force that pulls on its points of attachment to the skeletal system. Now, there is distance between line of action of a muscle and joint axis known as moment arm. This distance is helpful to produce torques around the joint axis by a muscle's force. But how is line of pull clinically important? Let's look at some examples to understand. Clinically, joint position affects line of pull. Here, as you can see, biceps produces force by pulling at its attachment. Let's call the force as FM. Now, R is the distance between force point by the muscle and joint axis. This distance is called moment arm. Force produced by biceps when elbow is 90 degrees flexed creates a torque or rotational force that rotates your forearm into supination. Another example of how joint position affects line of pull can be seen in the case of tensor fascia lata and gluteus medius as well. These are primary hip abductors, but if you flex your hip, their line of pull changes, and they can assist in lateral rotation. In another clinical example of line of pull, let's discuss some interesting muscular variations. You see, two different segments of a muscle may assist in performing two different actions at a joint because these segments have different line of pull. For example, gluteus maximus is prime hip extensor, but its upper portion assists in abduction and lower portion assists in adduction. Similarly, gluteus medius is an abductor, but its anterior part assists in medial rotation, while posterior part assists in lateral rotation. This is beneficial because our body will be recruiting fewer muscles for an efficient movement. Productivity at its best. The angle of pull is defined as the angle between the long axis of the bone, lever arm, and the line of pull of the muscle. Now you must remember the equation that change in joint's position will bring change in angle of pull and muscle's moment arm. As a rule, a muscle can produce maximum torque when the angle of pull is 90 degrees. Here moment arm is at its greatest length, so muscle's force produces only rotatory component. If the angle of pull increases or decreases than 90 degrees, muscle's force gets divided into two, rotational and non-rotational force. Non-rotational force would cause compression or distraction of joint surfaces. The farther a joint goes than 90 degrees, the more the non-rotational component is found, whereas lesser part would be rotating the joint. How is angle of pull applicable clinically? In your clinical practice, you should be mindful about angle of pull of each muscle that surrounds each joint so that you know which range is beneficial for exercising and what part of range of motion to avoid. As an example, consider a dislocated shoulder. Now such a joint should not be placed into positions that encourage surrounding muscles to destabilize it. This is the reason behind avoiding overhead movement or full lateral rotation in early part of rehabilitation of this condition. In these positions, the non-rotational forces that distract shoulder are quite significant. Let's consider another example of compression forces. As we discussed, non-rotational force component might include compression or distraction. Generally, compression of a joint makes it more stable, but there are pathologies wherein compression may be painful and thus undesirable, such as arthritis. So be mindful about not only the exercises you're recommending, but also of the positions those exercises should be done. Angle of pull is also a useful concept if you're strengthening a muscle and using external weights for the same. With free weights like sandbags or dumbbells, the maximal resistance occurs when pull of weight is perpendicular to the ground regardless of the limb's position. Let's consider biceps example for ease. When your patient is in supine, he shall get maximum resistance when elbow moves from full extension to flexion, i.e., initial range of motion, whereas in positions like supine and sitting the weight is perpendicular to ground when elbow is 90 degrees flexed, so patient gets maximum resistance at mid-range of motion. With that, let's wrap up for today. I hope you've learned today's concepts, and if you did, don't forget to like, comment, and share it with other physios. Thank you for watching.